everybody. Thank you for tuning in today. This is a virtual Discovery Lab lecture. My name is Samantha Askin, and I am a graduate student at the Virginia Institute of Marine Science. And today, I'm going to be talking about mollusks. Also, after the end of this lecture, stay tuned for more info on mollusks and activities that you can do at home. All right, so my talk is titled Gastropods, Bivalves, and Cephalopods, Oh My, Exploring the Different Groups of Mollusks. Mollusks are within the phylum Mollusca, and that includes gastropods, bivalves, and cephalopods. There are at least 60,000 species of living mollusks, and they are extremely diverse in experience. As you can see from this figure here, they all look very different. So I would ask you guys, what are some mollusks that you know? And if you have a favorite mollusk, I'll share that my favorite mollusk is the channeled whelk. That is a marine snail. And later on in this talk, I'll talk a little bit more about channeled whelk and why they are my favorite. Mollusks are very diverse, like I said, but most mollusks have these three physical features. A mantle and mantle cavity. So those help protect the internal organs of a mollusk, and they also can help with respiration or breathing. Most mollusks also have a foot or some kind of foot appendage, and that is basically to help in the locomotion or movement of mollusks. And then most mollusks have a nervous system, and that is to help with things like their senses and their motor skills. Also, mollusks can be found to inhabit or live in the marine environment, in freshwater environments, and in terrestrial or land environments. The first group of mollusks that I will be talking about are cephalopods. You are probably familiar with some of these. They are in the class Cephalopoda. Cephalopods include things like squid, octopus, and nautilus. So cephalopods are the most mobile and the largest of all mollusk groups, largest in size. There are about 800 living species of cephalopods, but in the fossil record, there are over 17,000 species that are extinct now. Cephalopods have a centralized brain and have highly developed eyes. So they have very extensive sensory organs. Many are also able to change color very rapidly. I'm sure you have seen this in some octopus that can change their color from orange to then camouflaging with the ocean floor. Cephalopods are very diverse in shape and size, and this has allowed for various types of locomotion or movement exhibited by cephalopods. They also have various predator avoidance or protection techniques. Like you've seen, some octopus and squid can use ink to help evade predators. The next group that I will be talking about are bivalves. They are within the class Bivalvia. You're also probably very familiar with some bivalves, especially if you live in the Chesapeake Bay or around it. Some animals within the class Bivalvia include clams, oysters, mussels, and scallops. So bivalves are easily recognized by having two half shells. That's where the name bivalve comes from. There are about 10,000 living species of bivalves. Bivalves can be found in freshwater and in saltwater, and they can use their shell to help them swim. A lot of the times they'll do this by opening and closing their shell, and that helps them push through the water. However, it's interesting to note that some bivalves don't have a shell, and they have evolved to lose their shell over time. Something else that's very cool about bivalves is they are very important for humans in several ways. So historically, we have used bivalves as a food source for many, many years. If you have ever eaten oysters or clams, those are bivalves. Bivalves have also been used in jewelry and in art. And also in the historical record, bivalve shells have been used as a form of currency or money. So that's very cool. The last group that I will be talking about is gastropods. And these are actually, this is my favorite group of mollusks. Gastropods are within the class Gastropoda. They include animals like snails, slugs, conchs, periwinkles, and sea slugs. So gastropods are very awesome. They make up about 80% of all living mollusks, with over 50,000 living species of gastropods. Something unique about gastropods as well is that they are the only mollusk group to invade terrestrial habitats or to live on land. And something else very unique about gastropods is they have this thing called 180-degree torsion or twist of the body. And that is why the shell sits on the back of snails. And this has led to many different modifications or appearances of shells. Here are some examples of different types of gastropod shells. Like I mentioned, they're the most highly diversified group of mollusks. And there are around 50,000 species. And all those species are comprised or are within around 400 different families of gastropods. These are just five examples of different types of gastropod shells, but there are many more. And some of the reasons as to why these shells differ in shape or appearance has a lot to do with the environment that these snails or gastropods live in. So the shells will form in certain ways depending on different environmental factors like temperature, salinity, what predators are around, what food sources there are for the snails to eat. So it's all very unique. That's just a brief summary of some of the different groups of mollusks. But now I'm going to switch over and talk a little bit about my research, which is on a gastropod. So I am a master's student at the Virginia Institute of Marine Science, and my research interests include population genetics and natural resource management. And my current research here is trying to use population genetics and genetics as a tool to better manage a fishery. And that fishery is the channeled whelk fishery. So channeled whelk are marine gastropods, and they are fished for consumption or to be eaten. And so my project really is to try to figure out how many populations of channeled whelk we have so that we could better manage those resources. This picture here is actually looking at three different whelk species or snail species found within Virginia waters. So this snail right here, this is the channeled whelk. So that is my study species. That is what I do my research on. But we also have the knobbed whelk here in Virginia. Both the channeled whelk and the knobbed whelk are native species, meaning they are from this area originally. But we also have a whelk species called the rapa whelk, which is non-native, meaning it is invasive. It is not from Virginia originally. Rapa whelk can be found over in Asia, and it was actually transported to the Chesapeake Bay via ships. And it has had a population here for around a decade or so now. So these three whelk are whelk that are found in Virginia waters. However, only the knobbed whelk and the channeled whelk are ones that are commercially important, meaning that we fish for these. Both the knobbed and the channeled whelk are fished for use in terms of food and eating them. I do my research on the channeled whelk. And one of the reasons why we want to look at the genetics of channeled whelk is we want to try to see how many different populations that we have. And one of the tools that I use is genetics, or looking at the study of heredity or the passing of genetic characteristics from parents to offspring. So here is a picture of an animal cell. And within an animal cell, there is a nucleus. That nucleus contains chromosomes, which are made up of DNA. And DNA is very unique to every individual. And so what I would like to look at is how the DNA is different from one channeled whelk individual to the next, and see if I can group them on differences or similarities to see how many populations we may have. And so as an example here, looking at population genetics, we have three snails, and what we want to know is which populations are these snails a part of? Population one, population two, or population three? And so by looking at the DNA of these individuals and seeing how similar or different they are, we can then group them based on populations. So as an example, we could have three different populations, or if there is connectivity or these populations are connected, we could also have one population where all these whelk are so similar, their DNA is so similar that they are all from the same population. It's important to know how many populations we have of a certain species, especially if we are fishing for them, because we want to make sure that we are fishing sustainably, meaning that we don't deplete a resource and that we have it and we can conserve it for future use and future fishing for the next generation. And so that's kind of where my research comes into play in terms of fisheries management, natural resource management, using population genetics, and trying to understand more about a marine gastropod. So that is it for my talk in terms of learning about the different mollusk groups and my research, but I do have a few at-home activities that could be fun to do. The first is to design your own gastropod shell. So like I had mentioned, there are many different shapes and sizes of gastropod shells, and a lot of times those things occur because of what's going on in the environment. So it would be a cool activity to make your own gastropod shell and then to describe what type of habitat your gastropod would live in. Another really fun thing to do that I like to do all the time is to participate in some science out in the field. So you could go for a walk on the beach and look at or look for interesting mollusk shells. And if you happen to find some, you can try to identify what type of mollusk it is. And then I also have provided some online resources that could be useful for those activities and just to learn more about mollusks in general. The first is an online science guide for mollusks that can be found at sciencewithme.com. You can also look at a field guide provided by the Chesapeake Bay program at chesapeakebay.net. Again, that could be useful for conducting some science out in the field, trying to identify the mollusk you may have found. Also, there's a kids encyclopedia on mollusks at kids.kiddle.co. And again, it's just another great resource to learn more about mollusks. With that, I would just like to say thank you for tuning in. And Tuesday night from 6 to 8 p.m., I will be on Facebook and available to answer any questions you may have about mollusks and my research. So I look forward to hearing from you.